favorite cartoon characters will help you understand how drugs and alcohol can ruin your life. So watch the program. Talk about it with your family.
Make the right decision.
Hi, everyone. Welcome to Special Presentation with Mike and Ethan, or...
Elf will not be seen tonight.
This is part two, totally two parts of Valiant. So it should be, like, Valiant with a big Roman numeral two for the L, Vatuient.
It's Valiant two. This time it's personal.
This time it's Valiant. A little reminder for you, Prince Valiant is a comic strip that feels sort of like reading a stained glass window, and it's been going on for decades, and in 1997 they made a movie based loosely on it that was produced in Ireland and featured a number of people who were kind of too good for it, and it really crashed and burned at the office. At the box office, not the office you gave at. So right now we are looking at it, and it is, and as usual, it took us this long to start talking about the actual plot and do the blow by blow. So yes. You might not have missed all that much, but but if you go back and listen to the other one, you're going to hear us talking about the celebrities who are involved in this in detail.
Yeah.
So where were we? Were we about to talk about harems?
We were, well, the harem in this doesn't make its big appearance till late in the movie, but yeah. We're talking about him anyway.
Yeah.
Because there's a harem in this movie, and they are, what a harem. They are...
They are all quite beautiful. You cannot ignore that.
Yes. They're a bunch of good-looking dames. They're all princesses in their own right. And they've all been kidnapped by, I guess, Sligon, the usurper. And now they are his harem. A bunch of them are dressed like, well, I don't know. It looks like they went to the Spirit Halloween store and got a Jasmine costume.
Yeah, know? Pretty much.
Yeah. A lot of them have, way more than I would expect, have like, nose rings with chains. So I actually thought for a while when I was watching, it's like, oh, is that like, did the Vikings put that on them as like a symbol of ownership or something? But then one of them doesn't have that. So I think it's just supposed to be an exotic Middle Eastern little flourish in this. Because I suppose. Yeah.
I confess there is no particular ethnicity that I associate with, you know, that kind of flirty nose ring.
No. I don't really, but like a couple of these princesses look like they were supposed to be dressed kind of like a Middle Eastern kind of belly dancer type thing, which I was like, oh, okay, harem. But I think the idea was that the Vikings stole princesses from a bunch of different cultures, but they all look kind of Middle Eastern to me. So
two of them are young and one of them is more mature, but other than that, there's not a lot of difference between them, unfortunately.
They don't have like a whole lot of screen time. They're pretty much just they remind me of like in the Mario Brothers movie when we get to meet all those like Guidettes that Bowser has kidnapped, you know?
Yeah. I'd forgotten about that scene. Yeah, that is what it feels like. Feels like they were looking for a certain princess and now they got the one they were looking for.
Yeah. So there's this one scene where like, I guess our main princess, Eileen, is like, gets thrown in with them and she's kind of like, who are you? And they're like, she's like, you can't do this to me. I'm a princess. And they're like, we're all princesses. Now we're just days of the week. you know, like I'm Monday, you're, this is Tuesday, and this is Wednesday, because, you know, Sligon fucks us on those days. And they're like, you're going to be Thursday. And Eileen's like, but today's Thursday. Oh no. So anyway, there's a harem in this movie.
Yeah. Honestly, but it never gets funnier than when they say to the harem with her and you hear her say, what's a harem?
Well, you know, in King Arthur, they don't have harems. So
No, they're Christians.
Yeah.
Or were they at the time? I mean, is that a later addition? Jesus does not come up and they talk about various gods instead.
They do. But the movie does end on a Christian note. We do have a resurrection at the end of the film.
That's true.
Which does come out of nowhere because
it really does.
Yeah. It's like there's been no indication of like, you know, Christianity being a force in this world up until that point. I mean, when did King Arthur actually live? I mean, I don't think he actually lived. I don't think he's an actual historical figure, but when is he supposed to have lived? I think in the world,
you know, between like the 900s and 1100s, as I understand it.
Okay. So
it is post Christ.
Okay. But... So Christianity did exist at this point. We know that I think in the Prince Valiant comic strip, which is not, you know, again, not particularly historically accurate, but they have him contemporaneous with the late Roman Empire, I think, even though all the dress and architecture and everything that you see in the comic strip indicates the High Middle Ages. So, you know, take that as you will.
When are the High Middle Ages?
That would be like, I think about like
every Sunday night, baby. Ooh!
I think that would be like the 1100s or something.
Okay.
Or maybe, I don't know. I don't know what I'm talking about. What was I going to say about the Romans? Well, King Arthur does have a druid that hangs out in his court and does magic. So, even if King Arthur is Christian, he's not particularly like, you know,
He's not a jerk Christian. He's like, you know, it's like how Robin Hood hangs out with a Moor.
Yeah, there you go. Man, you know, I'm surprised you don't have Robin Hood showing up in this either, you know?
Yeah, he would be maybe they're saving him for the sequel.
Yeah. I mean, I feel like, you know, the comic relief sidekicks are kind of like Robin Hood type characters. So, you know, you might as well have just put in some like, again, we're like greatest hits of the vague Middle Ages. We're going to throw in some Robin Hood stuff too.
It could be, you know, it could be argued that Boltar was like a bad Robin Hood since he's like kind of a man of the woods.
Who was
stealing from a royal chariot. But
he's basically, would Boltar be like, what is it? Like a wild man, you think? Does he count as a green man type figure?
That's one way of looking at it. Actually, honestly, my first thought was that he was the big bad wolf.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
Especially because, the night that, Valiant is traveling with says, this is home to the Jabberwocky.
Oh, that's right. Though there is no Jabberwocky. We don't actually see one. It does
just a cave that's kind of lamely, appropriated to look like a dragon face.
Yeah. I mean, that's the sort of thing that if they had a little more of a budget would have been really cool. I do like the way it kind of stays true to the Prince Valiant comic in that, like, there's very little, you know, like supernatural, like, you know, fantasy magic type stuff happening. I mean, there's a little bit of magic, but like, you know, we don't have monsters and stuff. And so they kind of work around that in some interesting ways that we'll get to, I think.
Yeah, that was a really interesting thing, but yeah, we will get to when the time comes.
Yeah. Oh, I should mention, because like we get to see the harem, you know, and they're like a bunch of hot ladies in skimpy dress. This movie is pretty PG, I guess.
Yeah.
But It's PG, but I don't think it would be accurate to say it's not horny, because there's definitely some stuff here that, like, you know, that they do manage to, like, make it kind of spicy with what little they can show.
Yeah.
Like, we do get, you know, when Katherine Heigl is, like, she dresses and gets out of, she dresses in, like, an oversized, like, shirt, like shift, basically. And
yeah, she's wearing her boyfriend's shirt. Yeah.
Yeah. She's wearing her boyfriend's shirt and she's all wet because she just got out of the weird, big, good, well-lit moat that they have in the Viking thing. And she's kind of just walking around like that. And, you know, there's like, oh, it's my boyfriend's shirt, conveniently stopping right below the butt. Right. Yep. There, you know, so you can't help but like, you know, ah, yes, I, you imagine that there's a butt under there. But also, Thagnar, who, you know, the bald baddie.
Yes.
We get to see a lot of butt with that guy.
Yeah, like, he has his outfit. There are places where you can just freeze it and just get full on Thagnar butt.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I think
like when he sits down in his brother's throne.
Oh yeah, like it is like watching that scene from what is it?
Fatal Attraction.
Yeah, the one, you know, the scene with the leg crossing, and is it Fatal Attraction?
I don't think it's Fatal Attraction. I think it's Basic Instinct.
Thank you. It's like watching that almost, because he does get stabbed at one point. And he falls down, and I think you can basically see his taint. You know.
Yeah, it's like, oh, you can see his whole area.
Yeah. So, you know, there's something for everyone in this movie. There is the bit where like Prince Valiant and you know, Princess Eileen are kind of having a moment, which is kind of like I thought. Pretty well. I mean, again, they can't do anything, but like they really, you know, she hurt her leg or something, I think.
Oh yeah. And she's, yeah, there's a scene where she like slipped and hurt her leg. And, you know, this is after she's figured out precisely who he is, because up until now, she thought he was Sir Gawain, because Gawain had hurt himself in the tournament and Valiant had been like, I'll just put on his helmet and fight for him.
Yeah, yeah.
And so she's sort of like, oh, it's you. It's the stable boy or something like that. But at the same time, he's like, I've done a little medicine. I can check out your leg for it. And he's like, does it hurt when I press here? Does it press here? And she's actually allowing him to go further and further up her leg. So, you know, she's being very permissive.
Yes. I think she actually is saying like pointing out higher and higher up her leg where he's supposed to check. So,
yeah.
And I think eventually he's the one who just says like, your leg's fine. Cause you know, he's a knight. He has to be honorable. So it kind of, he's the one who finally realizes, like, oh, I can't fuck Prince Arn's lady. That's not a good thing for a knight to do. But you know, I think it's a well done scene because again, Katherine Heigl, she's doing that chaste but horny thing that is a huge requirement for this kind of character because you know,
yeah, you can never have a. You can never have a truly slutty princess to rescue.
Yeah, yeah. She's...
Because then you're like, what are you rescuing her from? She's fine.
Yeah, she's having a great time. But yeah, she does get... what happens? I'm trying to think. I guess we've got to the point where the Vikings kidnap Eileen, right? They've taken her back to the harem.
Yes.
Prince
Valiant.
Oh,
she hurt her leg. No wonder she's called Eileen.
Oh, now Prince Valiant. Oh, they throw him off a cliff, don't they?
Yeah, they hurl him off a cliff and then he washes up on shore.
Yeah, so he's fine.
Yeah, he's fine. Even though he was, well, I guess he wasn't in full armor or anything, but, is this okay, no. Oh, but the whole point of the Vikings attacking him. See, this is because Morgana, looking into her really cool shattered magic mirror, is, you know, what's happened is they got away with Excalibur, but As King Sligon was fooling around and being a nut with it, it slipped out of his hands and jammed itself into one of the stones of the castle. And now nobody can pick it up because, you know, it gets stuck in a stone if it's not being wielded by the true king.
Yes.
So they're like, well, who else could... So she asks her mirror, who's the nearest true king that could pick this up that isn't Arthur? And it shows Sir Gawain riding on his horse. So they're like, fetch me Sir Gawain. Only to, of course, she doesn't realize it's not Gawain. It's Prince Valiant. It's Valiant, who is not yet a prince.
Right.
Playing the role of Gawain. And the princess doesn't know he's not Gawain just yet.
That's right. And did you mention why he's cosplaying as Gawain?
Yes, Gawain hurt himself in a fight with Prince Arn during the tournament.
Okay. So that is why the Vikings are now after Prince Valiant.
Yes. And also, Valiant humiliated Arn, so he's got a bone to pick with Valiant.
Yeah.
Oh, and also, the Vikings were cosplaying as Scots when they stole the sword, which means that now Arthur is about to make war on Scotland. So my question is, if they're referring to the land of the Vikings as Thule, why aren't they referring to Scotland as Hibernia?
Well, as we established, it's just, this is the grab bag of old timey stuff.
Yeah.
We've got it's kind of surprising we don't, because I think in the comic strip, Attila the Hun shows up at one point. So
after he attacked the kingdom of Id.
Yeah, exactly. So it's,
that would be so funny if there was it's the kingdom of Id. I knew it. That king is such a fink.
I mean, that would be it would be a natural crossover because,
I think that's a King Features thing too. So yeah.
Yeah. Where it's vague, the Wizard of Id is similar when you think about it, because it is a quasi kind of fakey medieval kingdom type thing. Right.
Yeah.
But ostensibly realistic in the same sense that Prince Valiant is. We don't get a lot of fantasy in it. There's no monsters or anything. We don't have no dragons or anything. It's the most fantasy thing is that the wizard can do a little bit of magic.
And he's got that spirit that comes out of his tub.
Yeah. Yeah. It's interesting how we can accept that it's the real world. Magic works. That's fine. We can accept that. It's not a fantasy world. It's our world. It's just, magic is there. Which
I
is
think a lot of people believe in magic in real life.
That's so true.
In a young girl's heart.
Wizard of Id and Prince Valiant both do that. Asterix kind of does that. Game of Thrones kind of does it too, if you think about it. I mean, they do have dragons in it, but
they have dragons and orcs, but they're cold. That kind of thing.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, we mentioned that there is magic, but there's also, we didn't mention, that there's steampunk-type technology in this world. Because, a couple of times we see characters using, I guess, what is their version of binoculars, which...
Yeah, what is that thing? It's always broken, too. It looks terrible.
Yeah, it looks like they just got the head of a giant fly, and they're just looking through its compound eyes. It's like something out of a Bog Leech comic, but
it barely works, but they keep using it.
There's stuff like that. It feels like when you watch Tim Burton's Sleepy Hollow and Johnny Depp pulls out those wacky, forensics things that he invented.
Yes.
It's like, oh, okay. It's not. I could conceive of someone coming up with something like this, but obviously these aren't things that exist in real life. We also get at one point, I think when the Vikings are doing the trick with the corpse puppet. Prince Valiant pushes a button on his armor and a fucking crossbow pops out.
Yeah. Again, they designed the action figure before they designed the movie.
Yeah. When I saw that, I was oh, I love Evil Dead. But that's just a one bit. It never comes up again.
Was the time of King Arthur before the time of optics? Did nobody wear glasses?
I don't know when. You know what? I would maybe, because when were glasses invented?
Good question. Let me look it up. You know, because
King
of
Arthur
glasses.
Is pretty old. You know, it's like that's like real old. Right.
Real old. Yeah.
Real old.
Oh, it says that corrective lenses emerged in the late 13th century. Huh.
Okay. So let's see. King Arthur was developed a figure of international interest due to the popularity of Jeffrey. 12th century history of. Okay. So when is he actually supposed to have lived? I want to see that. Okay, so apparently Arthur was supposed to have lived around 828. So that would before the invention of glasses.
Yeah. 500 years before. So yeah.
So he would not have, I guess they would not have had binoculars back then.
No.
Instead they had these weird steampunky looking things. But they use them so that they can they have other stuff in this movie, don't they? I'm trying to think. Are there any other weird devices they use, or is that about it?
That might be it. Oh, except for the King Slimy's motorized throne.
Oh yeah, that's right.
also, and toward the end, it's very difficult to see exactly what's happening, but there's some sort of weird, what looks like a death trap machine that Morgana gets involved with.
Oh, yeah. Because she falls into a thing, right?
Yeah, she falls into a thing. And, okay, what precisely happens to her? Oh, somebody here gets turned into... Oh, somebody gets turned into metal? What the fuck? I don't even remember that part when I watched the first time.
Yeah, I don't remember that part. Things happen real fast. This movie comes at you fast. Now I remember what happens at the end is Morgana puts like, she throws some like magical dust into Katherine Heigl's face, and Katherine Heigl sneezes it back into Morgana's face, which I thought was pretty funny, honestly.
Yeah.
And then that causes Morgana to fall into a big pot of soup or something and die, I think.
And not just die, her still crowned skull bursts out of the bowl and fastens itself atop a pillar.
Yeah.
While she hisses, "I'll be back."
I mean, that's pretty badass. That's pretty great.
I mean, if you have the option of doing that when you die, do it.
Yeah. I do think that is a great death scene. Way better than Sligon's, which is, okay.
Sligon's is just funny.
Sligon's is really funny because he, okay, so remember at the end of the movie, Excalibur is stuck into the floor of the Viking throne room, and like Thagnar basically shoves him so that he falls on the hilt, like
he
sword.
Gets impaled on the hilt of the sword. Oh, by the way, this is a really cool, this sword has a really cool hilt. It actually has the face of the Lady of the Lake as the pommel.
Yeah, like. That, I like that. There's a lot of like chicken fat in this movie that, you know, kind of makes it fun to just look at. Now, I don't think that the hilt of the sword will impale you. Usually, I think you would just like kind of crack your back on it, you know, but it goes right
but
through
him. But it goes right through him.
Yeah. And the pommel is like sticking out his front, completely blood free, by the way. There's no blood on it, even though it's going right through him. But I think that happens a few times where people get stabbed and there's no blood because they want that PG rating.
It's PG-13 actually. Oh, PG-13. So there should have been blood. I'm surprised.
Because, you know, Valiant does kill Thagnar at the end and stabs him, and there's no blood on the sword after that either. So,
yes. But the thing about this is that this feels like the whole thing, like it was all for nothing, because we see Thagnar toss his brother Sligon on the sword. You know, he throws himself on his sword as men would do in ancient times when they had failed as badly as you have. And he So you see him dying, and then the next thing you see is Thagnar holding up the sword, and it does a sort of transformer move where its hilt splits and changes in his hand, and you're like, wait, the whole point of this was to bring Valiant to pick up the sword, and you just did it? You just did it?
Oh, yeah, because he didn't do it. He tried early in the movie and couldn't, so... But he could do it, apparently, now?
Yeah, I mean... No, I mean, the point... No, what they did was they thought it was Gawain who was supposed to pick up the sword, and he couldn't, because they thought they were looking at Gawain when it was actually Valiant in Gawain's armor.
Oh, okay. So, wait,
so... So Gawain was like, too bad.
So can Thagnar pick the sword up?
I guess so, because now his brother is dead and that makes him king? Maybe? You know,
I guess that makes sense, but
is there another rule to pull a
sword and couldn't do it, or
do you also have to be like the last in line? I don't know.
I'm not really I sure hope someone got fired over this blunder, because
it makes no sense.
The editing leaves something to be desired in this film. But the important thing is that we get Prince Valiant needs to get to Thule so that he can rescue everyone. So right. Boltar and Warwick Davis basically get him a boat, and they row themselves to Thule. And that's where...
Oh, yeah. And that's where they're like, well, we're going to need to borrow some horses. And they're like, borrow? This isn't England. And then you have something blatantly stolen from the Pirates of the Caribbean ride, where you have the three guys they stole the horses from tied to a tree, and a dog sitting there holding the keys in its mouth.
What is this? Where is this dog from? Whose dog is that?
Who are these guys? Who are these guys about the horses? You just skip to them having the horses.
Yeah, it's like it's like I understood. I was like, okay, I guess these are the guys they stole the horses from. But then they chained them to a tree and they gave the key to this dog. Is it their dog? Is it just a dog? Whose dog is that? You know, it's not like. We've never met this dog before.
Yeah. But, I mean, it's a very cute dog. It's like a Jack Russell Terrier, but like, what is this what Warwick Davis was talking about where they're giving roles to their friends? Is this like Anthony Hickox's dog?
I mean, they're probably, yeah, I would. What other, it's like that otherwise, you think this dog got this role because of his acting ability? No, I don't think so. This is dog nepotism.
Yeah, he can. I mean, all you have to do is sit there with keys in your mouth. I could do that. I could play the dog.
Yeah, there you go. You could have a career in Hollywood.
Yeah. I could be a world famous key holder.
Well, they get the key. Sorry, they get the horses. And then I think what happens next, they find the people of Thule who are like, oh, Sligon is an usurper. You, Prince Valiant, are the true heir. So
yes, this is where it reveals that Val, the squire to Gawain, is in fact the true king of Thule. So he's Prince Valiant, and yes. There's a king here, but I guess it's not his father.
Yeah, he's more like I guess he's like the steward of Gondor type situation, you know?
Yeah.
He's like.
We're also told, we're told that Prince Valiant's father is King Aguar. And he was supposed to be going to hiding, and it was Boltar who actually brought him to England and dropped him off with the monks who named him Valiant.
And then just hung around in a cave kidnapping princesses.
Yeah. I guess that this is what happens when you don't give further instructions.
Yeah. Well, the important thing is he got there in the end. So, Boltar, Perchance or Pennant or whatever his name is.
Yeah. Pico. What the hell is his name? Warwick Davis.
Yeah. So they come with Valiant and I guess then they got to break into the castle.
Yeah, they got to break into the castle and this movie does a very good job of, you know, letting Warwick Davis, you know, just be himself and not make short jokes, but there is one joke that I think actually kind of hits, mm-hmm. which is that when the Steward of Gondor or whatever presents Prince Valiant as the true king and everyone kneels and Warwick Davis looks around and sees everyone at eye level with him and goes, well, that's better.
Yeah, that's pretty amusing. So then I think we're getting, are we almost getting to the scene?
We're almost getting to the scene. Yeah.
Okay. The scene that we've been very careful not to mention and not to drop any spoilers about this because let me tell you, wow.
Now I'm worried I'm not thinking of the same scene as you are. It's like, I wasn't going to build it up that much. What's going? Okay, tell me what the scene is.
Well, I mean, maybe I'm getting ahead of it. But like when I think Eileen and Prince Valiant are, you know, they're hung over a certain pit. It's got.
That does come a little while later. But yeah, first we have the scene where Valiant is infiltrating the castle, climbing up it like Link in Breath of the Wild. And we have, meanwhile, the princess and the new evil king are about to consummate their harem-age, marriage.
About that. Yes. What is he giving her? Because he puts like a pill in her drink, but like, what is he actually trying to do?
I guess he's trying to drug her, but she instead. You know, she pretends to drink it while what she's actually done is pour candle wax into his drink. And that that really takes him out in kind of Home Alone style. There's a lot of Home Alone stuff going on in this one.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's a cool little thing that happens because then he's like spitting up like wax. But also it's like you realize as soon as you put the wax in the drink, it's just going to solidify. It's not going to continue being molten wax in there. So.
It must have been a boiling drink or something. It was hot mead, maybe. Hers was steaming.
I mean, you know, I'm being churlish because it doesn't matter. But it is funny that like he put something in her drink that makes her drink like mist and smoke. Like an obvious, like when you see it, it's like, oh yeah, that's like a magic poison of some sort, right? Because it's got like smoke coming out of it. But his isn't doing that, you know. So. It's just funny because if I was a princess who'd been kidnapped by a Viking and I was about to like do the thing with him, yeah, about that, he came in with two drinks and he's like, I've got these two drinks. One of them is got like smoke coming out of it. You drink that one. I'd be like, well, that's obviously like that's poison. That's a poison. Why are you trying to fucking poison me? You want to fuck a corpse? And maybe that's what he's got going for here, you know.
They were both poisoned. I spent the better part of my life building up an immunity to smoky wine.
I mean, I guess he was trying to drug her so that I guess he's trying to roofie her, but
yeah.
It's a little unclear because it kind of comes out of nowhere. Like many things in this film. It's by the way, I guess it's, again, that's why this movie feels like it's not from 1987, feels like 1987, because casual roofing, that was, much more of an 80s
thing. It is the bad guy. I mean, right? Right? I mean,
he is the bad guy. You know, I guess I should say, not necessarily that the director of this film was endorsing this behavior, because this is the villain doing it. But luckily, Princess Eileen, she does the wax thing, so that fucks him up and he falls on the floor and rolls around and flashes his taint while she escapes.
With Excalibur, which she runs into the next room in time to throw to Valiant just as he's about to kiss Morgan Le Fay, who was wearing her face.
Oh, that's right. I forgot. Morgan Le Fay tries to do that seduction thing.
Yeah. So there's, you know, So Katherine Heigl runs in and she sees him and she's like, dabbling in watercolors, Eddie? And
Oh yeah, doesn't she? What is she actually does have a pretty good line though, if I recall.
Yeah, he says something like, "It's not what you think," and he says, "It didn't look like that from here."
Oh, that's pretty good. There's some good lines in this.
Yeah.
Then I think that this is about the time when Morgan Le Fay goes into the soup.
This is where she falls into the soup. She does the thing with where she blows like something that looks like the dust of broken heart from Willow into her face, and then she sneezes it back. And so what does that do to Morgan? I'm not exactly certain. She just sort of faints and falls. Yeah, she falls into. Yeah, it looks like soup.
Yeah.
She falls into a boiling kettle, and she looks like she's being flushed down the toilet. and then suddenly her fleshless skull bounces out and blasts her mirror to pieces by knocking Thagnar through it. And her skull lands on like the one side of the throne going, "I'll get you yet. Ah, you put that milk on your mush and you eat it."
Well, it looks like our heroes have, saved the day. It looks like they're all clear, right? They're fine. Everything's done. Everything's wrapped up with a neat little bow. Oh, wait, they're not.
No, because they're not because chickens.
Oh, was that what happened?
They knocked Thengar into like a chicken coop, and then suddenly, and because they knocked him into the chicken coop, they're suddenly outnumbered. And then the next thing we know, I believe this is the scene you were thinking of.
Yeah, this is incredible. So get ready. This is the money shot of the entire film. This is what you've been waiting for. You didn't know you were waiting for it, but boy, this is it. This is the moment. Prince Valiant and Princess Eileen, they're tied up. They're hanging from the ceiling above a pit. And in the pit, there are
saltwater crocodiles.
Yes. And they're wearing armor.
Somebody made armor for these crocodiles.
This is like, I mean, I love this. I love this. It's again, just going for the gusto. It's like, it looks like the end of like, what is it? Brotherhood of the Wolf, when they bring in the, like the monster in the armor. Or like, those battle elephants in Lord of the Rings. Like it's it's great. It's just it's the most ridiculous thing ever. But I love it. I just love the because at first I was like, what the hell is? Because I was like trying to figure out what was going on, and I was like, do they? I thought for a second, did they build robots? Like, are these supposed to be medieval like steam powered robots down there in the pit? You know.
And I was that would be so like, cool. We're gonna feed you to the robots.
I mean, I actually would have kind of been on board with that. It's because, you know, again, it's so ridiculous. But like, yeah, I could see that happening in this movie. You just like, you know, like one of those those Greek meth calculating machines that they did just by like blowing steam through a pot or something.
Yeah.
But saltwater crocodiles that they just put armor on, which again is also great. Also an amazing thing there. I love that these Vikings have so much cool stuff, you know?
Yeah, it's pretty cool that now all this is going to be going to belong to Prince Valiant now that this is his kingdom.
Oh man, think about that. That is cool. He gets to inherit like all his badass stuff.
Yeah. He gets to live in the Bowser room and have saltwater crocodiles and in armor. I mean, they remind me a lot of, you remember Hook? Remember how Hook turned the crocodile that ate his hand into a clock tower?
Yes.
Yeah. That was so fucking cool.
There's like, look, I mean, that is the thing, is like so many guys who like so many like lost princes, they inherit a kingdom and it's like, yeah, whatever. But like you've like inherited like the lost boys, like Tree Bower or something, you know?
Yeah.
Like all sorts of, it's like a McDonald's fucking play place, this castle. There's so much cool stuff. It should also be noted that this crocodile pit links up to the weird moat in the throne room.
Yeah. You know? So he can just let the crocodiles out and play with them? Awesome.
Yeah. Because that's what happens sort of at the end when, like, Prince Valiant, like, is fighting Thagnar, and Thagnar falls into the moat, and I thought, oh, of course, he's getting burned up in the lava, right? But no, he doesn't. It's just water, it turns out. So he's trying to crawl out, and then something happens, and I think, like, the gate opens, and the crocodile comes out, and it's like, oh, the crocodile's gonna eat him! No, it doesn't eat him! The crocodile leaps out of the water like a cat, and it goes for Prince Valiant instead, you know, and Thagnar is just kind of watching it like, what?
Yeah. And then it won't betray its master. Wow.
That is one loyal crocodile. You know, they say, you can't.
Man's best friend.
Yeah. You know, people say you want a friend, get a dog, but I mean, nothing beats the loyalty of a crocodile. Yeah. Nothing beats the loyalty of a cold blooded animal with the brain the size of a walnut, you know.
Lyle.
what a guy. What a man. I don't even remember how Prince Valiant defeats his crocodile. I think he just jumps on its nose or something, doesn't he?
Yeah, he just jumps on its nose and gets 100 points or something.
Yeah.
You know, this really does feel
mentioning that he escapes from the crocodiles in the pit because Warwick Davis gets some of that stuff that Morgan Le Fay was using to, and he throws it on them, and I guess it makes them freeze.
Yeah, they fall asleep or something. I guess it's a freezing thing.
Yeah.
Now, I do want to say that I wish they had established the hay fever thing earlier, so it would have been a payoff when she sneezes it back at Morgan Le Fay.
Yeah.
And I also wish that Morgan Le Fay had established this, you know, magic dust thing earlier too.
Yeah. Yeah. Again, a lot of unfortunate edits in this movie because just a little, you know, I think a little more attention to detail. Boy, this would be, you know, the new Krull.
And we mentioned the Super Mario Brothers movie before, and the more I watched this and put it together, the more I realized that's what it reminds me of.
Yeah, yeah. It definitely has that energy. Got to bring up again that I do not know what, you know, that lady, that Amazon who keeps walking around in the background with her flaming staff.
Yeah, I'm guessing that would be like Chromeheart, I think. Oh, no,
yeah, that makes sense.
Chromeheart is a guy. So I don't know who she is. I mean, she doesn't seem to get a name credited. Maybe she must be Flame. That
makes sense.
Hartwig. Yep. This was her only role.
God, but I mean, she is like, I'm sorry. She is such a scene stealer in this
show. Yeah.
Like you just spend the whole time in this movie being like, I want to know more about this. This person. But I also like that when you actually see her get a good look at her outfit, she's like literally got like garters.
Yeah.
You know, it looks so stupid. I love it. Halloween store.
Yeah.
All the way.
She is the one that the princess actually takes out. I guess, you know, girls can only fight girls.
Oh, yeah.
She hurls so Flame is about to tip over a bowl of something on the combatants outside as the loyal Thulians and the Vikings fight. And the princess throws a spear, knocks her down, knocks the tub of whatever she was going to tip onto her instead, and her fire wand, her fire-blowing hammer or whatever it is, catches this stuff on fire, and it splashes all over her and turns her into metal? Was she about to, like, pour boiling lead or tin over them or something?
I guess that must be what was going to happen. I think I blinked and missed this bit too.
Yeah, but that's where you see the garters. So,
oh, I noticed really early when she was getting the princess from the princess room, you know, okay. from the harem.
Yeah, it turns her into a silver C-3PO.
Oh, it's like that awful scene in Superman 3.
Oh, yeah, with the woman getting turned into the robot. Yeah.
Yeah.
Which, that's one of those things that either horrifies you for life or, you know, just reach into your pocket and stick that corncob pipe and puff on it for another 30 years.
Yeah, man. I remember seeing that as a kid and being like absolutely terrified of that scene. Like, oh my God, this is a horrible. It's so frightening. And then I saw it again as an adult and was like, oh, that's it. That looks like not, shit.
Yeah. You know, this is an important thing to remember. If there's a movie scene that you saw as a kid and you've never watched it again because it is so terrified you that you could not look back on it, quickly make a movie that includes your memory of that scene without actually looking back at the scene.
Yeah.
And it will be so much more extreme than the one that you actually saw.
Like, I remember, because like that scene in Superman, like my memory of it was like, that it was like a like an extended scene of like parts flying onto her, and like you even saw like a close up of her eye with like metal stuff going into her eye and turning her eye like metal, and then then she moves in this kind of like jerky almost stop motion thing and like points and like shoots lasers from her fingers. And when I saw the actual scene again as an adult, I was like, oh, none of that shit's in there. It's literally just someone wearing a terrible costume. I don't know why I was so scared. I don't know what I was scared of. It was like I met some like disembodied pants flying around. But
I feel like you might have mistaken it with, you know, when you were a teenager, you probably saw something at the anime club from Guyver, because a lot of that happens in Guyver too, both the anime and the American live action movie.
Oh, that could be.
I know that in the anime version, you actually see like a diagram of somebody's body as the control metal slides up their ass and enters their entire circulatory system.
Oh, wow. Okay. Well, you know, body horror for the kids.
Yeah.
See, this is why I don't watch anime. Anime's for squares.
Yeah, squares who like body horror. Wait a minute.
What I do like is Prince Valiant, because let's see. So he's defeated the crocodile. He defeated, how does Thagnar die? I can't remember anymore.
Slow motion sword fight. I mean, this is how you know that the sword fighters are not, you know, really, they didn't really have time to train, is when you do the whole sword fight in slow motion.
Oh, that's right. Because don't they both go for Excalibur.
Yeah, they drop the sword, but because it got lodged in again, once again, they have to rely on Valiant to pick it up again. Oh, and along the way, the princess gets cut down.
Oh, that's right. So the princess is now dead. Or is she?
Mm-hmm. The princess is now dead, and Thagnar gets cut down as Valiant runs to the sword and, you know, pulls it out of the ground with one swipe and plants it right back in Thagnar.
Yeah.
Oh, and this is the scene where Prince Valiant basically says, "God, you'd better bring her fucking back, or you're gonna be my enemy."
What a raw line.
That is such a fucking raw line. Damn, that is like a contract with God.
I gotta say, I was actually like super disappointed when God came through and brought Princess Eileen back to life, because I thought, man, that would be such a cool ending to this. Like, you know, Prince Valiant, I am now king of the Vikings and I am going to kill God. You know?
Yeah.
Like, get some
Final Fantasy action in here. You know,
yeah.
That's Prince Valiant vows to find the Holy Grail, use it to get to heaven, and stage an invasion of heaven and kill God.
I mean, that would be wow. That would be such a ballsy way to end this film. But also, like,
no movie has that kind of balls. I mean, have you ever seen a movie about a war on heaven where the main character were the ones conducting the war?
No. No, I don't think I do not think such a film would get made in America.
I would do it, but I would end it with, you know, the main character is finally getting to God's office and saying, give us what we want. And God would be like, you know, like Orson Welles at the end of the Muppet movie and be like, you know, draw up the standard, go to heaven, get out of jail free contract for these people.
Actually, yeah. I was actually thinking of an idea for a film that I don't think would ever get made. It's sort of similar, in similar vein, because I was watching some Barbarian movies recently.
Mm.
And, you know, Barbarian movies, I like them. They're fun.
Like Barbenheimer.
Yeah.
And Barbed Wire.
Yeah. Actually, Barbed Wire is kind of a Barbarian movie, I think.
Yeah, kind of. I mean, she's ostensibly a superhero character, but, you know, I don't think that villains or anything really plays a lot of role in Barbed Wire.
No.
I don't know. I've never seen Barbed Wire because I was so mad at them focusing on it over Mystery Science Theater, the movie.
Oh, wow. I forgot they came out at the same time.
Yeah. All I know is that they were giving out free comics based on Barbed Wire that was just unloading all of these supervillain characters at once that I don't think were actually in the movie. And there was some sort of like supervillain cowboy who was like unleashing tornadoes and going, got your achy breaky right here.
Oh, wait. Okay.
That sounds fucking rad, but I don't think it was in the movie.
I'm very confused about what barbed wire. I always assumed it's kind of a post-apocalyptic world. Does she live in fucking, but it sounds like she lives in fucking Buckaroo Banzai or something now.
Yeah, maybe that's why Barbed Wire didn't do so well. It was too awesome.
Yeah,
gonna have to look at Barbed Wire.
I mean, it kind of sounds like a very like, I mean, if there's like a cowboy who does tornadoes, it's like, okay, we're kind of getting into like, you know, like the Tick territory.
It was kind of the Tick and kind of Mega Man, because there was also this group of villains who just had like names based on what they could do. Here's Cutter, here's Bomber, here's Slasher.
Yeah. Okay. So apparently, it takes place in 2017 during the Second American Civil War.
Oh shit.
So we're a little overdue. John Titor, fucked up the timeline, it sounds like. Barbed Wire, owns the Hammerhead, a nightclub in Steel Harbor, the last free city in the United States ravaged by the war. She earns cash as a mercenary and bounty hunter, but the chief of police raids her club and to try and get Dr. Karina Devonshire, former government scientist with information about a new bioweapon called Red Ribbon being developed by her former superiors in the Congressional Directorate. Okay, so it's a little, see, it sounds a little Johnny Mnemonic.
And not only that, it doesn't seem to include any of those characters, although there is a character called Big Fatso.
apparently Udo Kier is in this as well.
Hey, Udo Kier, you know, I'll never not recognize him again. It's like, hey, it's Udo Kier.
It's like, oh, Sligon. You Sligon. Why were we talking about barbed wire?
You were talking about Barbarian movies, and I got a little too excited.
Back to Barbarian movies. Wow, that one person on Twitter who doesn't like us is gonna like listen to this episode and be like, I hate them even more. They can't keep on topic.
I feel like we're coming into our own if we're getting hate tweets. Honestly,
that's right. I'd name them and be like, hey, this one's for you, person, but I don't remember their name. And it's probably bad.
It would be rude.
It's like, we're doing, I remember, this just you know, for the hater.
Yes. Actually, I'm a friend of theirs and they don't know it's my podcast.
Oh, fuck, real for real?
Yeah.
That is very funny.
Hi, Val.
How did they not know?
I just dropped it in a Discord being like, hey, maybe you should listen to this if you like talking about comic strips. It's like,
Have they never heard your voice?
No. This was not a gang of my friends or anything. This isn't anyone who just, you know, hangs out and watches movies. We just communicate strictly through text.
Okay. All right. Well, that's funny. Anyway, this episode is going out for all the losers and haters out there. YouTube,
Val. Make us stronger.
Yeah. So, all right, Val, we forgive you. We know what you do. So the Barbarian movies, right? So the thing about Barbarian movies is they're all pretty similar, right? There's a standard way that Barbarian movies go. You know, they're usually, I know if you play D&D, they're always like, oh, Barbarians from the Frigid North, right? But if you watch Barbarian movies, they don't take place in the Frigid North. They usually take place in, like, kind of, I don't know how you would describe it, kind of like a deserty chaparral type biome, you know? It's usually like running across the Great Plains, and they're just city-states all over the place, right? And if you, the culture that you see is usually kind of Fertile Crescent type stuff, you know? Like, it's usually not very historically accurate, but you look at it and you're like, oh, this looks like it might be supposed to be like Sumerian or something, right?
Yes.
Okay.
I mean, that's where Conan lives, right? Sumeria?
I think so. That sounds right. So
it's not Sumeria, it's Cimmeria. So it's like a simulated Sumeria or maybe a cinnamon Sumeria?
I just realized, is it Sumeria or is it Sumer, actually?
Yeah, Sumer. Yeah, Sumer. I think that's what we call it now.
Okay. Well, in any case, it feels like kind of a Mesopotamian, Sumerian, Babylonian type, you know, world. Like, it's not like, not close enough to be any actual real life culture, but you can see elements of it in there. Okay. And usually who are barbarians fighting? Well, they're going to be fighting high priests and wizard kings who are starting new upstart religions that are spreading like wildfire, as we know from Seth and that snake cult in Conan, right? So
always snake men. Yeah.
Yes.
He-Man fights snake men. Conan fights snake men. Yeah.
There's a lot of snake men, you know, in barbarian stuff. It's a big thing, but here's the thing is, like, I was thinking, okay, you should make a barbarian movie that just takes place in actual real life Sumer Mesopotamia in the time of the Fertile Crescent. And who, of course, would be the wizard king with that upstart new religion? Jesus Christ. So he's got to stop the spread of Christianity, and who's destroying all the old gods, you know? Because, like,
does he win?
Because this is the good universe, the good timeline. Someone should give me a whole lot of money to do something like that, or just give me money. I'm not going to make the movie, but I'd still like the money. that is the way I like to do things. Anyway, that is a barbarian. I think that would be a good barbarian movie, and you could get Pamela Anderson Lee to play Barbed Wire in it too.
Yeah, why not? Yeah, you could get her. You could get her to play Jesus. No, there better. You could get Udo Kier to play Jesus.
I think this idea has legs. I think we should definitely make this movie. I mean, look, when was the last time that they made a good blasphemous movie that got everyone all mad? It's probably what, Last Temptation of Christ or something? Nobody's got the cojones to do that shit anymore. It used to be a thing. People would just make movies that piss off Christians all the time. You know, Life of Brian, Oh God, You Devil. Probably other ones. Nobody's doing that now.
Oh God, You Devil? That's bizarre. I mean, how much more harmless can you get than George Burns?
Well, yeah, but you know how these Christians are. They're always want to be mad about something. They're always mad.
That atheist woke George Burns.
Yeah. Well, I mean, and that's why, if this movie should have ended with the princess not coming back to life, and Prince Valiant declaring war on heaven. However, instead, he prays to God. She does come back to life. He has witnessed a miracle. This is like Lazarus rising from the grave. And it's just like, all right, well, just back to normal now. It's like, okay, dude. I mean, I know you live in a world where there's like Morgan Le Fay and magic and stuff, but I still feel like God himself interceding because you threatened him. Like Prince Valiant threatened God, and God was like, oh,
and
shit.
God blinked. Yeah.
I feel like that's kind of a big deal, you know?
Yeah. Like, we didn't even mention that Prince Arn died.
Oh, that's right. Prince Arn died, and Prince Valiant was like, yeah, that's fine.
Yeah. But Prince Arn died, and before he died, he also, he felt, you know, incredibly, you know, pain because the princess gave Valiant a ring and said that show this to Arn so he knows that I'm telling the truth. But Arn immediately, you know, he pitches a steroid fit screaming she would never take this off of her own accord. And so they have a big duel, and Arn loses, and eventually, and while he and Valiant are fighting together, he says, tell me the truth. Did she take that ring off by herself? She told me she'd never do that unless she wasn't sure that we loved each other. It's like, ouch, shit.
Yeah. I mean, that's the thing is like, they really like, you can kind of see where they're going here. It's like, oh, he's going to be kind of a tragic character. Like he's kind of tragic in that, like he gets, you know, cucked.
Yeah.
But you can also tell like he's an honorable man. So he's going to be, he's going to like step aside and let the better man take the woman. But then he dies, and oh well, I guess that wraps that story up with a neat little bow.
Yeah, you didn't even have to break up with him in the first place.
Yeah.
Yeah, you didn't have to send him that Dear John ring.
It works out really well for Eileen.
It really does.
But then
so I gave him back his ring, sucker.
At the end of the movie, because then I think Prince Valiant, because King Arthur is basically like, well, I don't got the sword, got to disband the round table. Let's call up the Japanese and give them our unconditional surrender. Then Prince Valiant like busts in and he's like, I got the sword. Here's the sword, King Arthur. And I also bring a lasting peace with Thule, you know, which is where I'm king now, by the way. Come visit me in my crocodile playhouse. And then I think like he's all like, can you like give me your blessing to marry this Welsh princess? And King Arthur's like, ho, 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 of course, my boy.
Yes, I am her dad after all. Oh, wait, no, that her dad is now a puppet.
Oh, that's right. Is her his dad? Was the dad the one that got killed earlier?
No, he was like her teacher, her, you know. He wasn't her dad, but he was like the adult she was raised by.
So about like two guys that she in theory had really close relationships with got killed in this movie, and she just does not react at all.
No, she is just so hot for Valiant that she just can't, you know, she can think of nothing but those lips.
I mean,
and meanwhile, Warwick Davis is just standing there with his hat in his hand, like, wow, me next.
Yeah, I mean, you know, the lips are pretty. Those are pretty. He's got those dick sucking lips. They're, you know, not too bad. It is funny because at the end, I feel like Valiant could be like, you know what? I'm King of Thule. But like now that I know I can threaten God into making stuff happen, I mean, the sky's the limit. You know.
You know what? So yeah, was it Prince Valiant's power that God fears, or is it Excalibur?
Oh.
Is the Lady of the Lake stronger than God?
If, you know, that makes you think. If God and the Lady of the Lake got in a fight, who would win? You know, that's some real... Whoops.
Maybe strange women lobbing scimitars is a good system of government.
I mean, it's definitely working here. So, Prince Valiant, what do you think? What do we think about Prince Valiant?
This is very much one of those movies that would be an absolute joy when you see it when you're 7 at daycare.
Yeah.
It is, you know, it's one of those movies that you aim it at adults and they're like, oh, come on, are you kidding? You give it to kids and they're like, yeah!
Yep. I kind of love it. The editing, if it was edited just slightly better. Just slightly better. I mean,
you know, if the storytelling is a little choppy, a little weak, but the actual, you know, the events that take place in it are all a lot of fun. The characters, not all of them are that much fun, honestly, but the ones who are good are worth it.
Yeah, yeah.
But it's not really about the characters. It's just about the events.
Yeah. This is one of those movies that, like, it feels like it should be a cult classic. You know, it should be, because I had never even heard of this movie, so it's kind of weird to see it and be like, oh, look at all these big names in it. Look at all this cool stuff. Nobody remembers this movie? Could it be that, like, people saw the... did people actually go to watch it or and decide, oh, it's a bad movie? Or do they just see Prince Valiant on the poster and think like, oh, that incredibly boring comic strip. Why would I want to watch that as a movie?
I don't know. I mean, that was my thought. It was like, I have no memory of seeing this, but I remember being like, oh, Prince Valiant. That is something that I am profoundly not interested in seeing.
Yeah, I feel like this is just that typical Hollywood thing where they're like, yeah, yeah, we got the rights to a pre-existing property, you know? People love things that they've heard of. And it's like, yeah, you know what? Maybe rethink that strategy, you know?
You know, all I can think is that, I mean, our actor playing Prince Valiant is okay, but I can't help but think that this got started earlier in the decade when people... were first discovering what an incredible talent they had in Keanu Reeves. Wouldn't he have made so much better of a Prince Valiant?
You know, he does have the right energy for this role.
He really does. You know, I really, especially because this is a movie, you know, that ostensibly takes place in England, but they really didn't push themselves to do the accents. So if Prince Valiant had had this kind of voice, you know, like if Prince Valiant had sounded like Ajax from Duckman, you know, I think it would have really sold the idea.
Yeah. I mean, I definitely think that, I think that would have gone over a little smoother than what we got.
Yeah, I think, you know, I mean, do you think this movie is trying really hard? Would you say it made a valiant effort?
You know what? I think it did. I think that this is a movie where they're like, look, we've got, the director or the writer was like, you know what? We need to keep people entertained. We need to keep people watching. Just throw crazy shit at the wall. Doesn't matter. Does it have to make sense? No. Does it have to be good? No. It just has to be interesting. It just has to be stuff that just you're like, what is going to happen next? What wacky adventure are these guys going to do next? And, you know, to some extent, I mean, there's only so far that can go, unfortunately. Yeah. But boy, I kind of love that what it was trying to do.
Yes.
And I think it's something that I'm going to be talking about for a while and, you know,
something you're going to be talking up and being like, you know, hey, everyone on Twitter, watch this insane movie.
Yeah. I think it's definitely a sort of movie where, I mean, I'm like, look, do you know, Prince Valiant, you know, that comic strip in the paper, the boring one. Well, what if he fought like a bunch of, leather daddy Vikings and armored crocodiles and, also, he had a steampunk telescope, and what else is there's some other stuff in the, I mean there's a lot of stuff in this movie.
Yes. I think I think there's a secret element of success to this, which is that, you know, they brought you in. I mean, actually no, the secret element of failure to this is that the name Prince Valiant brings in fans of Prince Valiant, but common sense tells you that you should include as little of the actual Prince Valiant comic as possible because no one cares.
Yeah.
So they brought in the few people who would care and they were like, hey, this is nothing like the comic. It's like, yes, you're welcome.
It's one of those things where it's like, I'm sorry. They're like, I'm sorry. We made a movie too good.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, we've run into a lot of movies like that, honestly.
Yeah. Well, I think everyone who's listening should go out and watch Prince Valiant 1997. It's free on Tubi.
Yeah, and when it's not free on Tubi, it'll probably be free on Pluto, probably free on YouTube, and they probably put it up on archive.org. Who's going to notice? I don't know.
Man, you know what? Thank God that some shit out there is still, you know, the man hasn't clamped down on yet.
Yeah. So, are you looking forward to seeing a more accurate Prince Valiant? Because there are a few others.
I cannot think of anything I would look forward to less, to be honest.
Well, hopefully maybe there'll be a Prince Valiant 2050 AD or something that we can look at. That would be fun.
I mean, at this point, though, I think we're contractually obligated to look at every Prince Valiant adaptation since we've started. Yep. We've started down this rabbit hole.
We did it with Dick Tracy, and now we have to do it with this. Honestly, we're just delaying watching more of those Blondie movies.
Yeah. Well, yeah, we'll definitely watch the other Prince Valiants first. And maybe Barbed Wire, because that's probably based on a comic or something.
Yeah, it's based on a comic book by Dark Horse, I think.
Sure. Yeah, sure. That counts. Why not?
Why not? Yeah. It's our show. We can do what we want. Maybe we'll look at Barbed Wire. Maybe we'll compare it to that free comic that has all these characters that aren't in the movie.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I mean, what else? I mean, unless y'all want us to do more Snuffy Smith movies.
Snuffy Smith.
We know how much our audience loves Snuffy Smith. They can't get enough Snuffy Smith.
These snuff heads, you know, you just can't sate them. You know, we can't snuff them out. There's, you know, they keep Googling us.
A real bunch of snuffluffaguses.
Let's say that Snuffy Smith fans, that is the official name for them, is Snuffleupaguses. So
yeah.
We'll see you at Snuffleupagus Con 2025.